Welcome to Praise Hands, home of the Praise Hands, where we are all about creative, cross-cultural Christianity. I'm your host, Robbie Valderrama. This episode is brought to you by thechurchahead.com, resources and advice for forward-thinking Christian leaders, including coaching, contracting, and courses. One of my favorite things about this podcast is highlighting creative, cross-cultural solutionists who are leading powerful, beautiful, and sacrificial lives, just like Jesus did. As the founder of Black Christian Influencers, Chicago native Jackie the Educator is one of those leaders. With a background in cross-cultural reconciliation, Jackie has a two-part vision. First, to see Christian influencers from various cultures affirmed in their respective cultural identities. And second, to see those various cultures united for the multicultural cause of Christ. During this episode, Jackie shares about the importance of Christ-like reconciliation, provides education around a few of the factors preventing racial equality in the United States today, and opens up about the hidden wounds of the African-American community. So let's grab our lunchboxes, tie our shoes, and hop on the bus. Jackie the Educator is going to teach us a few lessons. I am here today with Jackie the Educator. Hello, Jackie. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm doing so good. So you are a Chicago native. How is life up in Chicagoland?
It's cold sometimes, but it's looking good for the now. You know, it's not too cold. We're actually getting some decent weather. So it's a good time to be in Chicago.
So Jackie, tell us your story. Who is Jackie the Educator?
Yeah, so Jackie the Educator is a lot of things. I created the name in part because I wanted to be able to talk about a range of topics. And I felt like the only person or few people that are able to do that are educators. I feel like we are versatile. We're able to be someone who can be knowledgeable on a lot of things, but not experts. We're able to kind of learn and enforce critical thinking skills. And so Jackie the Educator came from that, started off as a podcast. It grew into me now having a show on YouTube and also creating a lot of cool things with a group called Black Christian Influencers. So Jackie the Educator is a lot. I can't even explain it all in like one podcast. How much time do you have?
I definitely hear what you're saying about the concept of being an educator. And that's something that I've tried to find as hosting this podcast. I mean, one of the problems that I've seen about our society today is that because things can be kind of siphoned off, you know, you've got the graphic design majors over here, the art majors, you've got the math majors, you've got the science majors, you've got the religious studies majors. And there's a severe lack of interdisciplinary studying that is happening. And because of that, because we're so siphoned off, we're not able to instinctively come together in a cross-cultural, if you will, way to be able to make solutions that work systemically or holistically. So I see a huge need for what you're doing. And I think what I'm trying to do with this show as well, and really bridging a lot of those gaps, because there's these resources, there's connections, there's insight, there's wisdom that are in these different pockets of society, and including the church as a microcosm of that. And by being able to bridge those, it's really helping that synergy and helping us get a lot more out of everything that we have.
Absolutely. I agree with you. I think that's even why I brought together the Black Christian Influencers, because it was just a place where people of all backgrounds could come together and be able to talk about important issues. Like, we have an attorney and singers and painters and doctors, you know, all types of people who are now feeding and building each other in a community where we can kind of talk openly and honestly. So that's what we're doing now with this, and higher learning has been a part of that as well. And I'm excited.
That's the name of your podcast?
Yes, Higher Learning is a podcast and vlog on YouTube. So it's definitely growing, and we're excited about where it's going.
No, that's so good. So you started Black Christian Influencers earlier, or I think late last year, was it?
Actually, it's December, actually, of 2018. So about 4 months ago, that's when we started it. And it has just been an amazing blessing. It started off even on my page, Jackie the Educator on Instagram. I just was highlighting people that I thought were inspirational and doing amazing things in the world. And, you know, I was like, wow, we really need a place where we can highlight these people even more. Like a whole, what if we had a whole space devoted to just just highlighting people who are doing great things in the kingdom. And so that's kind of where this came from. Black Christian influencers is a small piece of a bigger puzzle. And I'm hoping that as time goes on, God will lead me when we should move on to the next phase. So it's a great thing that's going to happen, starting off with Black Christian influencers and hopefully leading up to other racial distinctions so that we can eventually all come together.
What I love about the approach that you're taking is it's saying, hey, we're not disregarding our culture. We're not disregarding our backgrounds, but we are saying it's kingdom first. And how do we orient that in a way that's glorifying God, that's honoring each other, and that's acknowledging the beauty that's in each of our cultures?
Absolutely. And it's just something that is needed. I mean, if you look on a strategy side of things, that's how we do it in our own racial reconciliation areas. I think a lot of people, if you talk to experts, it's a need first to come together and have some community first amongst different backgrounds as far as race is concerned, and then be able to come together. Because if we're coming into it with pain and undealt with hurt, even things within our own culture, it's not going to be a whole conversation, because we're being held back by our own false ideations of how the kingdom should look.
Wow, that's so good. There's like so much in that. I'm like, I have to like listen back to that again. But you know, there's just that saying, hurt people hurt people.
Yes.
And I think the reverse is true, where healed people heal people. And I think as we come together, as we're able to be able to see some of those wounds healed, I think the sky is the limit really for what we're going to be able to do. So I love what you're doing.
Thank you. I'm excited about it. You know, obviously it's all God, because I'm like, I couldn't be that masterful in designing such a platform.
Right.
But after he kind of did it, I'm like, oh, that actually makes a lot of sense, God, you know, to do it in this manner. And I'm just believing him to do amazing things.
Yeah, for sure. So looking in the Black community, what are some of those wounds that you see? What are some of those spots where there's pain points and really things that have not been dealt with? How do you see those problems and those issues becoming healed?
Yeah, so I mean, in the Black church, there have been a variety of issues. We're a charismatic bunch by nature. We have a lot of things that we do very well and flamboyantly, but a lot of that has led to people feeling as if it's fake. We've had a lot of issues within the Black community of, you know, people doing one thing in public. They're this amazing, I'm going forth and, you know, very charismatic and, you know, spiritually deep. But then in behind closed doors, they're not living that same life, or they're not even halfway being led how they're performing to be in public. And so that has created a lot of divide within the Black church. We've had a huge of pulling away within the Black community and the church in general. They're not pulling away from the faith, I believe, but the church. And I believe that the church is needed in this next phase that God is going to take us into. We can't just walk away from the church and say, hey, we're going to do our own thing. But I believe that God is calling us to restore the Black church and to reframe the image of Christ to where he's on display, and not our cultural heritage traditions, you know, and things that we do just to get attention, because we lacked it at, you know, the inception of how we were introduced, some of us, to the faith, you know. And so I believe that a lot of that has caused for us to have a lot of smoke and mirrors in front of Christ instead of just seeing him for who he is.
I see. Maybe almost like a compensation where it's like, we've been hurt. We can't come across as weak. We've got to kind of be strong, be demonstrative, put stuff out there. And because of that, there's this disconnect, almost an inability to reconcile the internal feedback and the external feedback that we're getting.
Absolutely. I mean, we're not called to be perfect, you know, and we like to sometimes create these images that we are perfect, and that, you know, the church is, whoever is a preacher or, you know, leading in the congregation is without sin, you know, and only Christ is without sin. We are daily coming to Christ and asking for forgiveness because we sin all the time, you know, and a lot of us don't understand that we are not perfect. And so even within Black Christian influencers, I want to slowly chip away at that need for us to put up this facade as if we are something that is holier than thou, because that is not mm-hmm. Christ. That's not how he wants us to be perceived.
I think that's really insightful. How do we, and this I think is applicable to all cultures, how do we take that biblical command to be holy and to be sanctified and be on that journey, but acknowledging our humanity? Where do you see, and I'll speak specifically to Christian leaders here, how can Christian leaders pastor people and shepherd people through that context of sanctification, of the being going there but not being there yet?
Yeah, I think it's going to call for something that we hate, which is transparency. I believe that we are very hung up, for good reasons, on how we are perceived. I believe that Christ will lead us, though, to in ways that we can do it where we're not hurting anyone, but in ways that we're actually showing people the way. And I believe that if we continue to do the way that we are doing, we're going to have a lot of people who think that Christ is unattainable. You know, so there is a need for leaders to be transparent in the fact that they do sin. Guess what? You know, I'm not perfect. You know, that has to happen. And it needs to happen in a way where people can be encouraged to do it and not demonized for it.
Sure. So looking at the state of the Black church, one of the things that inspired me to start this podcast was looking at these different movements like the Hebrew Israelites or Nation of Islam, these different things where the masculinity in particular in the Black community is not something that is really being promoted within Christianity. And a lot of these organizations or communities are coming alongside and saying, hey, we can give you manhood, we can give you a sense of purpose. And it's around Black nationalism, Black pride, these sort of things in a superior sort of way. And what is your take as someone that is leading the Black Christian influencers? Where do you see the church intersecting with these movements? What do you see going on?
Yeah, I always like to boil things down to a simple solution, because I believe that's where all of our answers are. There is love. I believe that if we love within our communities and showing people who are part of different groups the power of it, they'll be open to hearing us better. Right now, we're going back and forth with groups, Hebrew Israelites, or even people who are maybe not even Hebrew Israelites, but are definitely racist, you know, within their own faith as a Christian. We have to disarm them, and that's going to be done with love, you know, and obviously some of the great people have already come to that conclusion, you know, because when you hit people with love, it disarms them in a way where they can't even continue to attack without first receiving what you have. And so I believe that that's where we have to start within these groups and organizations that are, you know, spewing out hate or, you know, saying messages that are not, I believe, how Christ wants us to be. You know, we have to first come at them with love and not attack what they believe. But once they're disarmed, enter into a conversation and listen to them and address their needs. Yeah.
One of the things I appreciate about what you're doing is bringing people together through friendship. My wife will say that friendship is like a safety net.
Yeah.
Having close connections, people that you trust, people that you're in community, maybe even interdependent on, is a way for you to be able to avoid kind of getting weird.
Yeah.
You know? And so how do you see what you're doing as supporting that sort of safety net or that friendship within BCI, Black Christian influencers, and beyond in the rest of the church?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think a lot of people don't take social media as seriously as others, you know, but I believe that as Christians, we are not utilizing one of the most valuable tools of our time as well as we should. Social media connects us in ways that we've never been able to before. You know, people come into your church congregation, you see the clothes that they have on and the face that they're giving, but you don't see their family pictures. You know, you don't see them with their kids or having random moments of fun or what their thoughts are in the middle of the day. We have that ability now with social media and using mm-hmm. that platform as a way to now interact with people who before were already separated in more than one way, but now we're able to connect with them on a personable manner where now I know your son, I know your daughter, I know how mm-hmm. they look, you know, mm-hmm. I like their pictures, I mm-hmm. think you're funny. I've connected with you in more than one ways. So when there's one way of disconnect, it's not going to separate us completely because now we're connected in other ways, you know? And so that's mm-hmm. kind of how I believe this movement is going to happen, especially with Black Christian influencers and beyond, and what we're planning to do with even Christian Influencers United. I believe the internet, social media gives us a tool that will allow us to really come at the kingdom in a different way. The world is using it very well right now, but as Christians, I believe that we have something that, you know, we've got to start using a lot better.
All right, time for a quick commercial break. Today's episode is brought to you by thechurchahead.com, resources and advice for forward-thinking Christian leaders. If you have a heart for racial reconciliation and would like more information on culture coaching for your organization, stop by thechurchahead.com to sign up for a free 30-minute discovery call with me, Robbie Valderrama. Now, let's get back to our show.
I'm going to ask a couple questions specifically on race and on African-American history in the United States. So first of all, a question that maybe some of our listeners might be wondering, is it Black or African-American and why?
Well, some people call Black, some people say African-American. I believe that the African-American phrase is used by mostly people who are outside of the race. Mm-hmm. lot of times I feel like it's a way of being respectful, you know, without mm-hmm. using the negative connotations that has in the past been associated mm-hmm. with Black people, you know, but most Black people or African-Americans have now embraced Black, you know, mm-hmm. as who they are, because, you know, even though it was defined
Pan-African.
Yes. Yeah. You know, it's definitely something that we've now learned to have our own meaning for. You know, I'm Black and I'm proud. You know, a lot of the things that mm-hmm. we've done mm-hmm. now to change what was at first negative into, you know, our own definition of it is what we have now. But honestly, I believe you could call Black African-American, you know, some people who are African, you know, sometimes get a little annoyed by this term because right. you're not African. You've never been to Africa, you know, you don't live mm-hmm. there. And so I've heard that conversation and that debate. I say Black all the time because I believe it's the cultural mix of what we have now that encompasses where we are.
One of the challenging things you mentioned, you know, people saying, you've never been to Africa, you can't be called that. One of the, I think, most challenging concepts for us to wrap our head around with this concept of race is the intergenerational impact of race. Brian Loritz, I don't know if you're familiar with him. He's a speaker and a pastor, and he wrote a book called Right Color, Wrong Culture. And in it, he gives this analogy of looking at a football game. And he said, all right, if there was a football game, you've got two halves. The first half, one of the teams had to play, you know, football with like their hands in handcuffs, and the other team just ran all over them. And the score was like, you know, 1,000-0 at the end of halftime. What is the most fair way to be able to end that game knowing that both sides had a fair chance? A lot of, I think people outside the Black community, in particular in the white community in the United States, look at where we are with the race today in the country and say, I didn't do anything. I've never owned a slave. Mm-hmm. I've never XYZ. And I think a lot of people in the Black community are like, hey, I know you never personally did anything, but like, but I'm still in this situation that I'm in today because of what happened by your ancestors. Correct. So how do we communicate that in a way that is not accusing, but is also saying, hey, we're really behind the curve, and I don't mean this in a condescending way, but in a lot of these financial, if you look at the rates of home ownership and intergenerational wealth, the statistics on the Black community are far behind the white community and a lot of other segments of society. So how do we move from here?
Yeah, I think that's a question that we've been battling for a while within the world in general, right? And I've talked to people who have said that, you know, I haven't done anything to you. I don't believe that, you know, I'm your mm-hmm. friend. You know, why mm-hmm. are you still having this need to, you know, want to have your own group or Black Lives Matter or things of that mm-hmm. nature. Why do you need that? You know, and I feel like there has to be an explanation, a conversation had that explains that, you know, although you were not a part of it directly, there are still effects of it happening today. And until that is rectified or, you know, a solution is found, we will continue to have the need for our own individuality that allows for us to be platformed in ways that would allow for us to come back to a level of wholeness, you know, because we're still hurt. We're still dealing with, like you said, the systematic oppression that was done to our ancestors is still in place. Those systems have not been changed, and mm-hmm. people need to know that not acting is just as bad as doing the act. And so if you know that these systems are still in place, we have proof of that. You know, the fact that you are not acting on it or doing things to, you know, try to point out the injustice in that is just as mm-hmm. bad as being a part of it.
A lot of people outside the Black community don't actually see there being systematic injustice, because there's not really a lens for it. What are some of the things that you would be able to say, whether it's a statistic or something where you'd be able to say to somebody and they'd say, oh, wow, that's more than just like your opinion or you feeling hurt or you just kind of need to get over it?
Yeah, I mean, like you said, if you look in the housing area, I stay in Inglewood, that's where our church is, right? And so mm-hmm. this neighborhood has been demonized as one of mm-hmm. the most violent areas in the world, you know. And so Inglewood mm-hmm. is a mostly Black community, and a lot of the things that were happening in Inglewood happened way before, you know, we even got this whole notion of, okay, you can pull yourself up by your bootstraps, you know. Mm-hmm. We didn't even mm-hmm. have bootstraps back then. So a lot of things that right. you are given as white people, maybe people who have, you know, certain privileges, that mm-hmm, thing mm-hmm. that they have, it's something that was given to them. We were not given things. And so mm-hmm. within that community, their parents are passing on what they never had. And so that's mm-hmm. never a good way of building, if that's a nice way to tell people, is that, you know, if you're starting off here and I'm mm-hmm. here, you know, mm-hmm. we're going up, there's never a catching up. So until we're mm-hmm. able to catch up, it's not going to be a place of equality. And so that's what we mm-hmm. have to strive for. So within our communities, you know, we were behind the ball with being able to purchase homes where we wanted to. So the fact that we're able to kind of do that now is mm-hmm. still, you know, an overarching problem, that the fact that for a long period of time we couldn't. And so now we're settled right. in areas that were traditionally built not for us, you know. And so a lot mm-hmm. of things we kind of have to do really is focus on bringing equality.
So talk to me about Black-owned businesses, mm-hmm. let's say specifically within the church. What should the church's stance overall be towards Black-owned businesses? If you had a conversation and you had, let's say, 10 white pastors in a room, and you got a chance to say, hey, here's why I want you to support Black-owned businesses, what would you say?
Yeah, I would appeal to just justice in general. A lot of the things that is happening within our communities, especially for leaders, is that we have the energy, we have the drive, but we lack the resources. And the resources are lacked because, one, we weren't taught how to use it. A lot of people, when I went to college, I went to a traditionally all-white Swedish covenant college. And so all of my friends that were white, their parents taught them about investing. They, you know, they had mutual funds set up for them, and, you know, their college was paid for. Forget loans. Why are you doing that? You know, so it was a setup for them in the beginning. And so a lot of what we are trying to do now is get to a place where we can do what's needed within our communities, but we need the resources to do it. And so there are some great initiatives happening with people who are trying to help their communities get up to the level that's needed. But first, we kind of have to be invested in order for us to be able to produce that return.
Right. A pastor named Duke Kwan, he gave a talk at Q Conference last year on racial reparations. And I would advise anybody that is kind of exploring this topic, if you get a chance, check out that talk. You can look up just anything from Duke Kwan, D-U-K-K-W-O-N, you know, on YouTube, and that will provide some good historical context, specifically from the church's lens. So, what other resources or or maybe advice or things like that would you point people towards if they want to learn about the church and intersecting with people of color?
Yeah, I would say that, you know, be allies, be supporters. A lot of times you see these groups where it's, you know, black, blah, fill in the blank, and you assume that you're excluded from that. That's generally not the case. A lot of times it's just a space for, you know, the individuals to come together. But it would be so encouraging if people of different races were to start to recognize what's happening. Because the reason for it is because they were overlooked in the first place. The reason why someone does Black-owned businesses or support Black Christian influencers is because there was a neglect that started within that community. And so this is an effort to correct that neglect. And so the fact that you are paying attention to it and supporting it feeds into what we need, which is support. We need affirmations. We need to be able to be seen and heard. And so if the church would come together and recognize the neglected individuals within the body, I feel like we would start to come up. Just like with victims of abuse, a lot of times they want to be seen. They want to be heard. You know, they don't want to feel as if they're they don't matter. And so we kind of have to approach it in that manner, is that, you know, this community has been abused in our history. So we have to begin to recognize that by looking at it and giving it a voice.
Yeah, that's so good. So looking at church in general in North America, let's say in the United States, do you think that we can solve these racial disparities, racial issues without multiracial and multicultural church congregations?
Yeah, no. It's solve is what the key word that I'm listening to. Can we begin to alleviate or move towards, you know, in our segmented areas? Absolutely. And that's needed, because you can't just jump from 0 to 100. There has to be a trajectory and, you know, a process. But I believe that it's needed at the end of it for it to be solved, is that we kind of have to come together. We have to have this united body of Christ, because that's what Christ is calling us to.
No, that's so good. If you had to kind of leave people with something like, hey, this is my big nugget that I would want everybody to take away from my life, what is most important to you as Jackie the Educator?
Being led by God. That's just the main thing that you kind of have to have in your mind at all times. All the philosophies and, you know, things that you've kind of come accustomed to knowing, if you are not led by Christ, then you will not succeed in the kingdom, you know. And I think we have to be kingdom minded, and Christ will lead us into the directions that we have to take, you know. And we can go in those directions in peace, knowing that, hey, I'm led here. I'm just doing what I was told, you know. And so when some people are like, well, how could you start Black Christian influencers? Why isn't it, you know, hey, I'm just doing what I'm told, you know. And I believe that Christ rewards us by the fruit. The fact that this group has grown from 0 to almost over 6,000 followers within only 4 months speaks to the fact that Christ is, you know, interested in this work, and he wants us to continue going forward. And so my end goal is to be a united kingdom where we have these different races coming together, these different backgrounds as far as, you know, occupations coming together, because we all have technical skills that are needed in the body, and our diversity is what makes us great. I'm a huge nerd, and so I like Power Rangers. Have you ever seen that before? Okay, so Power Rangers, at the end of the episode, they always have this huge fight, and the Megasaurus, they come together with the foot that, you know, was a car at once, and then the arm, which was an airplane, and you know what I'm talking about? So where they form this mega monster that, you know, fights against the enemy. That's what I envision the body of Christ being, is that, you know, we kind of have our own lanes, and we can fight on our own for a period, but there's coming to a point where there's going to be a battle that we have to unite together for. So yeah.
Wow, that's powerful. I mean, I that's definitely what I see as well, where we're getting to the point as a church where we need to be honest about the fact that we're not winning this battle. And it's not a battle against Joe Schmo on the street, or certainly not against the people of a different color than us. It's a that's a battle against the principalities that are absolutely keeping people in bondage, you know, and against the darkness. And until we, it's kind of like you being in education, if we're not grading people on the right outcome, we might feel like we're doing okay. If we're grading people on, oh, how many people did I get to show up to my service and how much do people drop in the bucket? And that's our metric for success, then we're missing it. Absolutely. So I believe that we're called to say, you know, what are we really called to as a church? That's to make disciples, that's to love, that's to be able to be growing, to be more like Christ, and to be able to really to restore this earth to what Christ created it to be. And so if we're looking at that as our scorecard,
yeah,
man, we got some work to do and we need each other. We're absolutely not going to be able to do this separately. We're not going to be able to go build our own kingdoms here, build our own kingdoms there. You know, I think it's a race issue. It's also an economic issue. It's basically an issue of preference and of us choosing to do what's comfortable over kingdom first. And
absolutely,
that can manifest itself in many different ways. And as believers, I believe one of the best things we can do is be agents of healing in those different areas of disconnect and bringing people together, calling people to a higher vision. So I love what you're doing through BCI, through the more initiatives that are going to be rolling out soon. How can people learn more about you, about what you're doing? What do you have coming up that you're really excited about?
Yeah, well, I'm excited about our platform, Black Christian Influencers. We're going to be moving to a website that's built on community hosting features. Like, we're going to have a lot more discussions, a lot more workshops, a lot more virtual mm-hmm. conversations happening amongst our mm-hmm. group that need to be done in a way that's not so public. And so we're going to mm-hmm. have spaces where it's kind of members that are able to come together and have these conversations transparently. And mm-hmm. so even outside of that, there's a bigger picture of Christian Influencers United. Once we begin to perfect the dissemination of Black Christian Influencers, we're going to take it on to other nationalities and begin to really unite the kingdom after that. So large goals, you know, but I'm excited about what God is doing with that and just beginning to move within the kingdom.
That's so good. Well, thank you so much for your time today, Jackie. I'm looking forward to seeing what God does through you. And I think there's a lot of good stuff coming. We need each other, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. All right. Well, God bless you. We'll chat soon.
You too. Have a great day.
I hope you enjoyed your time in the classroom. I know that I did. So, Praiseans, we are 8 episodes in. How are you liking this? I've jokingly told people that my goal is for everyone to be comfortable about 75% of the time. So if you're substantially less comfortable than that, thanks for hanging in there. I'm proud of you. If you're 100% comfortable, something might be wrong with you, but still, thanks for listening. If you have feedback on this episode or have a guest that you think should be featured, drop us a note at praisehandspodcast@gmail.com. If you love this podcast, one of the best ways you can spread the word is by rating and reviewing this show on Apple Podcasts. If we can get 100 5-star reviews, that could really open up some doors for us. So thank you in advance for your help. Lastly, I get asked all the time for reading recommendations. If you'd like to get a text from me every Monday with what I'm reading, text the word Robbie to 72727. Again, that's Robbie, R-O-B-B-Y, to 72727. Praise hands, y'all are the best. I'm your host, Robbie Valderrama. Can't wait for next week.